One of the things that drives me absolutely bonkers is clutter. Is it the same for you? You don't have hours to spend decluttering, so I'm going to share with you how to declutter your home as a working mom. These are three steps that you can implement today to have a clutter-free home. Number one, designate specific areas for common items. It's been a long day at work. You pick up your kids from after school care. You get home and then they dump everything everywhere. Their backpacks and jackets and shoes and who knows where they put their homework or that permission slip that you're supposed to sign. You also have your purse and your keys and your glasses. So you create something like a landing zone where it's a designated area where you put common items that you bring in and out of the house every day that you need to bring with you, like shoes and jackets and bags and keys. So you designate a specific area for those items that are frequently used that you bring in and out every day. It could be near the door to your garage where you enter or your front door, wherever it makes sense to you and your family. You can use standalone furniture that has cabinets or drawers. You can use cubbies, bookshelves, hooks, bowls for keys, trays for shoes, as long as it fits within that space and everyone in your family has a spot within that space where they're going to put their backpack and shoes and things like that. It helps reduce clutter because things are not all over the place. They know exactly where to go to get their things in the morning. They can grab their lunchbox, put on their backpack, their shoes, and head out the door. It just streamlines the process and helps teach them responsibility and organization. For example, in my kitchen, I have a junk drawer that is not actually filled with junk. It's a utility drawer. We have a pair of scissors there, measuring tape, scotch tape, pens, and magnets. Those are commonly used items, and that is the specific area where we put those items. So anyone in the household can go there and find a pair of scissors. Number two, have regular decluttering sessions. And I don't mean regular once a year, you're going to declutter for 2 weeks in a row, right? Or even one whole weekend. That might be too tiring and it doesn't, it might make decluttering like such a chore, right? If you have regular decluttering sessions, it gets built into your lifestyle. So I have an area in my landing zone that is specifically for donations. Things can be put in there, and then once that is filled, I bring it to Goodwill. Sometimes your decluttering sessions can be naturally built into your schedule. For example, school's going to start and you're going to buy a few more clothes. Maybe you get some your school supplies, things like that, maybe a new backpack. So that's a natural decluttering session or schedule because they have to get rid of clothes in order to get new clothes. So I did that with my kids, especially for where I live in Phoenix. It's like hot and hotter, right? No, I mean, it does get cool during what we call the winter months, but during when school starts, it's like August and it's just hot. So we naturally got rid of clothes because if they wanted new clothes for school, just, you know, a handful, not a whole bunch, then they would have to go through their clothes and get rid of some or donate them. Also, right before Christmas could be a natural decluttering session because if they want new stuff, things will have to come out. There's also spring cleaning. And then there's also at the end of the school year, right? We get rid of papers and notebooks or, you know, just supplies that probably got torn up or not in good condition anymore. Or maybe for you, you lost weight or you want to simplify your wardrobe. So that's another natural decluttering session that you could put in. Change of sports seasons could be another one. Or events like weddings and vacations can allow you to have a time to declutter. Or you could designate every quarter you're going to declutter. Maybe the first quarter you're going to do your closet, second quarter the bathrooms, third quarter the bedrooms, fourth quarter the garage. You know, think about it. Think about what your needs are and your family's needs. So I've got a story to tell you. When my daughter was 8, you know, there's a lot of clothes that she had in her closet and she wanted to, I had posed the option, hey, do you want to get rid of some of your clothes? I think someone who's a year or two younger than you would really appreciate these totally cute clothes, because she did have cute clothes. And actually, a lot of those clothes were hand-me-downs from a friend and her friend. So we went through her closet, even like the toys or stuffed animals and her clothes. And she literally had like four bags of stuff, okay? Probably two bags of clothes, and then the other two bags were, you know, games or toys or things like that, or crafts. And so in our neighborhood, if you put stuff on the curb, it's gone, okay? It's usually gone no more than 2 days. It's usually gone by that same day, right? So we put it out there probably like, I think, 2 or 3 in the afternoon, because I remember it was still light outside. It wasn't like we put it at night and it was gone in the morning. So we put it out, and then I was so happened to be in her room. We were in her room for something. And I happened to hear that there's a car, you know, kind of outside. You can kind of hear it, right? So we looked out the window, you know, we looked through the shutters, and there is a mom and her daughter, literally you could tell was probably a year, probably 2 years younger than her. And they got everything and put it in their car, and then they drove off. And I tell you, my daughter was so happy. And I said, how do you feel? She's like, oh, I feel so good that someone's gonna use my stuff, because I know it was like, you know, it was stuff that made her happy that she loved, and now she could pass it on. So it was an opportunity for me, not just to teach her about decluttering or organizing or taking care of your things, but more than that, that she could pass on that joy that she had with those things. So let me know in the comments below if you have a story like that, where when you decluttered, whether it's for you or your kids, that it brought a reward back to you, or like there was something bigger that happened to you than just the actual decluttering or the decluttering session. Number 3, implement the one in and one out rule. Hey, listen, this is not the first time you've heard this, right? But we need to hear it again, because it totally works. So for me, one of the things that I found in the last couple years has been hard is the baseball caps. I mean, I don't play baseball. I haven't played softball in forever. But when I go to like events or on vacation, I see the cutest baseball caps. And I see people on social media, or I see friends, and they got the cutest baseball cap with whatever sayings or logo or places they've been to. I think it's the places that you've been to that always gets me with the baseball caps. But I designated a long time ago that in my entryway closet, there's this, you know, like kind of hooks where there's 4 of them, and there's a top and bottom, meaning 4 baseball caps is my max. And I remember I got to a point where it was 12, and I was like, okay, Sherry, you need to implement the in and out rule. So I did that, and I got down to 8, and then I think I'm down to 6. I know I have 2 that I could put back in. It actually makes me really pause when I want to buy a baseball cap, right? With, I think like the last place I was in San Francisco, or I was at my alma mater here. Can see here, Cal Berkeley. I was like, oh, I need another Berkeley cap. I already have one. And I said, I already have one. Okay, don't get that. Then I was like, maybe I should have a San Francisco baseball cap. And I was like, no, you have only 2 spaces left. Are there any of the 6 that you want to let go of? No, I still like them all. So I was like, okay, let me wait. So it actually stopped me from purchasing something, because I know that is my designated space. Some things for you to consider for your one in and one out. Notebooks, books, school supplies for your kids, their toys, blankets, pillows, shoes, jackets, watches, oh, sunglasses. That was another one of my Achilles heels. I had at one point probably like 6 sunglasses, and I've managed to bring it down to, I think 2. I have my regular one, and I have one for like sports, which, you know, usually for sports, I just wear a baseball cap. Everything, everywhere, all at once. That's ever since that movie came out, that's what I've been describing as stuff. you know, stuffitis. You can't have everything everywhere all at once. It just doesn't fit. And remember, the goal is not to be able to count, I only have 6 baseball caps. It's really the environment that you want to live in. You want your kids to grow up in a space where you can breathe, you are relaxed, they can breathe, they can enjoy, they can have their friends over, you can have your friends over. Number one, designate specific areas for common items. Number two, have regular decluttering sessions. Number three, implement the one in, one out rule. By prioritizing these steps, you can have and maintain a clutter-free home. If you'd like tips on how to maintain a clean home, click the next video.